Greg, we're midway into the year. When you think about the first half, so many elements affected that investing landscape. Of course, Russia's invasion of Ukraine, inflation still dominating that narrative. Lockdowns in China seem to be easing up. As we head into that second half, what are you looking at from your vantage point?
Well, the first half was really ugly. And at the end of the day, there were no hiding spots. And really, when we're looking at the first half, you have to kind of look at what happened in the second half of last year, because at the end of last year and all the way through the pandemic recovery, it seemed there was too much easy money out there. There was flooding the system from central banks and governments, and it had to go somewhere. And really, it was the everything bubble, but it really centered on crypto and equities and risk assets. And everything really came into 2022 on an inflated valuation level. So I think as the Fed started changing tone, and that's been the big narrative all year, is that central banks are now realizing that they got to deal with inflation. And that's been the big story, is they've started to take away this easy money, started to become more hawkish and increasing bond yields. And that's really caused a full reversal of everything that worked in the last few years, unwinding this year. So it's been a really tough year to start the year, with the NASDAQ down over 30%, the S&P down 20%. And the TSX had been a good hiding spot with the commodities, but that seems to be giving it up in the last few weeks, as we're getting more recession fears than anything else. And I think the second half of the year is going to be all about, can the Fed be successful in dealing with inflation? And if they are, can they start to back off and go to more neutral? And that could be setting up for a nice bounce into the end of the year, but it's probably too soon to call right now.
I've heard you mention central banks a few times. Is that what's happening now? Investors are being guided by central banks?
Yeah, I think that's probably one of the shames we've got right now, is that the whole adage of don't fight the Fed has worked, because for a while it was don't fight the Fed because they wanted the markets higher, and that worked for 2020 and 2021. But now they really want the markets lower, or they really just don't care about the markets and they're all about inflation. So don't fight the Fed still works, but the Fed really isn't your friend right now. So central banks are really focused on inflation and not protecting the stock market like they had been for the last few years. And it's all going to be about central banks and when they start to back off and become more neutral. And I think that's the big trick for investors. And that's where every economic data point throughout the summer and fall is going to be super important, because any hint that CPI is going to start to peak and pull back, I think, could be a reason for the Fed to start to lighten up a little bit. And that would be good for equities.
You had mentioned some of the themes, and I'm thinking that they're probably going to carry over into this second half when it comes specifically, I guess, to food, to fertilizer, to energy. How are you, or I guess, how should investors be thinking of portfolio strategy when those are some of the overarching themes? And of course, I'm going to throw in inflation, and you mentioned recession as well.
Well, I think the real assets are going to be a good spot for investors going forward. And that has really been an area that has worked in the last few months in relative terms, though we are seeing copper and oil start to pull back as these recession fears are out there. But really, it's going to be hard to bring on a lot of supply. So if the Fed is successful, it keeps demand higher, but there's no real way to get this fixed from a supply point of view. So as much as there's been a pullback in energy and copper, I think this is probably not a bad time to look at this, because this feels like an area that if you want to protect yourself from inflation, you want to have exposure to real assets. And while the stocks have pulled back and as they've been caught up in the recession and fears and the market sell-off in the last little bit, I still think having commodity exposure is not a bad way to be to protect against inflation for the second half of the year.
And especially when you have someone like Warren Buffett standing behind that energy sector, what does that do?
Well, I think it's a huge vote of confidence for the energy stocks. And you have to remember, the energy stocks had really been forgotten for investors for a number of years. As with the ESG mantra out there for a while, everyone was saying, well, why don't I just get out of energy and focus on tech and other areas of growth? But we've seen right now that as demand's coming on, there's no real supply that can come on quickly. So energy companies that had figured how to work and be profitable in a $50 to $60 oil environment are incredibly profitable now, with oil over $100 in WTI. And what they've done differently this cycle than last is they're not putting it back into the ground or doing acquisitions. They're returning it to shareholders. And I think that's what caught the attention of investors like Warren Buffett, saying these are incredibly cash flow generating machines right now. The management's doing the right thing, giving it back to investors. And they're still trading at really attractive valuations. So Energies, I think, is an area that you want to be overweight for the next year or two, because there's really no supply that can come on like other cycles to dampen it out.
How do you think about tech stocks, I guess, in that vein?
Well, tech's really been the sector that's been hurt the most, and certainly spec tech has been hurt more than anything else. But I think what we're going to see right now is if we can get a pause in these move in interest rates, that could be good. And we might see a bit of a break in the tech stocks. Certainly all tech can't be treated equally. The large cap tech stocks really should be looked at more as defensives than anything else. So you could see a bit of a break and a bounce in the Microsofts, the Googles, the Amazons at some point in the second half of the year, if we do get interest rates to pause. But I still think it's going to be too early to go back to some of those speculative areas of the unprofitable tech stocks, because that's the sector that got really overheated. And I think that's going to be the last to rebound.
Whether you want to think about crypto as a speculative area or not, curious to get your take on where you see that headed.
Yeah, crypto's still trying to figure out where it fits in investors' portfolios. I think in the last 6 months, it's been treated more like a risk asset than anything else. And really, it got inflated as much as everything else at the end of last year. So when Bitcoin got to 60,000, I think that was really participating with the everything bubble and caught up with the move in the NASDAQ and other risk assets. And really, that had to unwind. But the big question is going to be where the low is in this cycle. Crypto's been famous for having these big crypto winters every 3 or 4 years. And we're certainly at another one right now. But it can bottom out in the $15,000 to $20,000 range for Bitcoin. I think that's a win at the end of the day, and could be setting up for a move higher once investors get more confident and ready to return back to our risk assets.
Bigger picture, how does the market story differ on both sides of the divide, especially when you bring currency into the picture as well?
Well, currency has been the biggest factor right now. And I think when you're looking at investors and what the big sphere that they need to fix outside of the bond market is the strength in the US dollar. The US dollar has been on fire this year. And really, in Canadian dollar terms, it hasn't been noticed that much. But when you look at it versus the yen or the euro, the US dollar euro is almost at par, which it hasn't been there for a long time. So the US dollar has definitely been a big area of strength. And that's not good for international companies, because if you're a multinational selling into other jurisdictions and bring it back to reporting in US dollars, that's going to be a weighing on your earnings growth. So I think the US dollar needs to pull back a little bit. We need to see some confidence that Europe is going to recover and not completely collapse here, and other areas of the market need to start growing. So US dollar has been a headwind for investors. So far, Canada has been able to escape a lot of the big downturn, but for the rest of the world, the US dollar has been a big hit.